Okay, now, when the church first started out, and they were singing in people's homes, in caves, grottos, out in the middle of the woods, their sound system didn't work either. So we're okay, because guess what? We have the Spirit, and we have the truth. Now, when I started looking into this, again, I probably gave you a bad image, me laying in my bed at 2 o'clock in the morning, but when I was laying there thinking of that, in my mind, I knew that, when Jesus talked about worshiping the Lord in spirit and in truth, that's the way that would happen in the future. I thought, wow, that's a really good verse, and it kept pounding on me, and I couldn't get back to sleep, so I went over to the computer, spirit, truth, typed it in, and 12 verses came up. And I read all those verses, and it was just like, thank you, Jesus, because this is a really nice thing. And it's interesting that it was also 12 verses, because if you study the Bible a little bit, you understand there's meaning to certain numbers. There's not coincidences in the Bible. There's God's instances in the Bible. So what is the number 12 with? Can you think of any 12s that are in the Bible? Yeah. 12 apostles. There was also how many tribes? 12 tribes in Israel. So that number signifies God's power and authority and governance over things. Foundational things. You'll also find, if you look in the Bible, you'll also find when we get to heaven, how many gates are there? There's 12. How many angels are guarding those gates? 12. Now, I think this is fascinating. When you look at there in the Bible, it talks about the gates. They're pearly gates. And those gates are so massively huge, they're cubits high and cubits wide. They're made out of one pearl. That's a big pearl. So that's telling you right there, God made that. That wasn't made by nature. That's a supernatural thing. So this number 12 has a significance in the Bible. So when we look at this, I looked at this as kind of a gift from God saying that this is perfect governance of mankind over in these foundational statements that you will see the Spirit and the truth presented to us. So we're going to examine this, and we're going to see what truth and that the Spirit illuminates for us. So the first one, David, of course, is beloved of God, the beloved king. There's only one beloved king in the Bible, and that's David. And this is him in Psalms saying the first usage of the word spirit and truth in the King James Bible. And this is so indicative of each and every one of us as Christians when we humble ourselves before God. Into thy hand I commit my spirit. Now, didn't you? When you got on your knees for the first time acknowledging Lord God as your Savior, you're handing your spirit to Him. Your dead spirit that is within each and every one of us until it is livened and quickened by God. We're spiritually dead. And it's then that He redeems us, just like He did David. And notice the title here, O Lord, God of truth. And that is the only real truth that we can find in the world today. So much fake news out there. So many lies out there. I've almost stopped listening to the news. I look at it not as the news being reported to me. I look at it as what they're presenting to me. And I take everything with a grain of salt and I compare it to the real truth. John 4:23 is the next verse. And these are all sequential. This is the order that they're in the Bible. John 4:23, and this should be very familiar to you. This is when Jesus is talking to the Samaritan woman at the well. This is part of that. And we'll see two usages of spirit and truth combined as we discuss this passage. John 4:23 says, But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. And the woman saith unto him, I know that the Messiah is cometh, which is called Christ. When he is come, he will tell us all things. And Jesus saith unto her, I that speaketh unto thee am he.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. A lot of people say, well, Jesus really didn't say he was the Messiah. They've never read the Bible. He thought he was the Messiah. So you're confronted with that right there. Either Jesus is a liar, a madman, or he's telling the truth. Because he didn't dilly-dally on this topic. He threw it out there. He did so privately. This is the first time he did this. He did so privately with this woman. And thank the Lord God, she was a Gentile. Kind of. She was a Samaritan. But she was not of the house of Israel. They considered themselves non-Israelites. So it was presented to her. And what did he say? Shall worship in spirit and in truth. Because God is spirit. So what does that mean? Worship in spirit and in truth. Well, we're going to get into that. But we see right off the bat here, just for, you know, three verses into this, that we have to worship God in spirit and truth. There's not another option, is it? Or you can do something else. No, this is it. This is the way you worship God, in spirit and in truth. So should we be doing that? You betcha. You betcha. So we better figure out what Jesus is talking about here. Because, you know, and again, he stomped his foot here. He said it to us twice. So let's look at the next verses in the Bible that talk about spirit and truth, and we're going to figure out something fairly quickly. The night he was betrayed, Jesus included this teaching as he taught his apostles. John 4:17 says, even the spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it seeth him not, neither knoweth him, but ye know him, for he dwell with you and shall be in you. So this spirit of truth, notice the capital S. Capital S indicates a pronoun. This is an entity, a human being. Well, I should say a being. So it is a personage. And it says, for he dwelleth with you. So this personage is dwelling with them. But notice it says the following, and shall be in you. I'm sure that the apostles were going, did you already say, what did he mean by that? What did he mean by that? That this capital S spirit entity will be living in you. Well, Jesus provides further clarification. This is the first time that this has been presented to them that we know of. In the scripture, to the apostles, this truth that Jesus is passing on right now. John 15:26. But when the Comforter, notice the capital C, is come, whom I will send unto you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he shall testify of me. And ye shall also bear witness, because ye have been with me from the beginning. So this Comforter, with a capital C, is also a personage. In fact, it is even the same person as this Spirit of truth. And it shall come, and God, Jesus Christ, shall send it from the Father. So we have Jesus Christ talking about a gift coming from the Father, talking about him. So we have here a picture of the Trinity working. Jesus Christ is telling us how it is going to work. He's opening this up for us to view for the first time. This is a mystery that has never been exposed to mankind before at this time. But this mystery is at the heart of this spirit and truth on how we will worship God in the future. Isn't this amazing stuff? I mean, it's amazing stuff when you set this down and look at this. But there's more. Sixth verse into this, John 16:13 says, "Howbeit when he," the Spirit of truth that we have talked about in the previous verses, "is come, he will guide you in all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he will show you things to come." So here we have this Spirit of truth that is going to come, and he will guide you. And who's he speaking to? This "you" is not just speaking to the apostles. This "you" is written down for us by the Apostle John for all ages, for the church age people, so we can see this and know it is speaking to us as well. And again, notice it says, "For he shall not speak of himself." So the Holy Spirit is not speaking of himself. He is speaking of the Trinity, of God, of Jesus Christ, of the promise that is to come and the fulfillment that is coming shortly. "But whatever he shall hear, he shall speak." So again, he's in communion. The Trinity is in communion, dealing with this. And here we have the Holy Spirit to come to provide this interface to us, this inward, indwelling interface that comes from God. Wow. Now this is dynamite, world-shaking, world-reforming concepts that Jesus Christ is presenting to the world. And we get to look under the hood right here to see where it is all formed for the first time in the Word of God and presented to the apostles to encourage them, because they would have to send this message to the world. Those things to come. Now, we're moving on to the Apostle Paul. Now, at this point, what had already occurred? Well, the Holy Spirit had already come. Pentecost is when we see in Acts, if you look at Acts chapter 1 and 2, you'll see where the Holy Spirit of God rained down upon believers and indwelled them and lit them up like a fire that looked like it was flaming on their heads, and they spoke in tongues. So this is after this fact that the Holy Spirit did come, as Jesus had just referred to. In Ephesians 1:13, of course, this is written by the Apostle Paul. He provides further illumination from this truth that shall come. Ephesians 1:13, "In whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth." Now he's speaking to the church here. "The gospel of your salvation." So what is the word of truth? The gospel of your salvation. "In whom also after that ye believed, ye were saved with that Holy Spirit of promise." So you were sealed with this Holy Spirit of promise that is to come. So it comes in sequence there. You have to hear the word of truth, which is the gospel. After that, you believe, and then you're sealed. So right here is the mini way in which every human being takes that first step, a personal relationship with Jesus Christ, right here in these verses. Now, the word of truth, and we heard some verses earlier today, the gospel of your salvation. Now, we were talking about news earlier. What's the gospel? Gospel literally means good news. You know, this is not just good news. This is the best news that mankind has ever received. That though they be sinners, and born in physical separation, spiritual separation from God, God has reconciled himself unto mankind through the blood of Jesus Christ sacrificed on the cross. And because of that sacrifice, that good news, that he has taken your sins and mankind's sin upon himself and offered this up to mankind, to mend that bridge between God and man. That's the good news. That Christ died for our sins, was dead for 3 days, rose again from the dead, and because he defeated death through belief in him in a perfect sacrifice as the Lamb of God that Jesus Christ was, we too can live for eternity if we but believe. And that's that humbling again. We must humble ourselves and believe in order to receive the sealing of the Holy Spirit of promise. Now, again, when you were saved, I have to ask this question. How many of you were made perfect? Have you sinned since you were saved? Everybody has. Oh, do I have any hands? Has anybody not sinned since they were saved? No, that's not the point. The point is not what you do for Christ, it's what Christ did for you. We will never obtain perfection through our own efforts, through our own works. That is only done, that perfection. Our sins are only made perfect through God. The Bible tells us that even our most wonderful things that we do in our works to try to attain a relationship with God are nothing but filthy rags. In fact, if you look at the actual word in the Bible, it tells about the filthy rags. They were menstrual rags at the time, which if you're a Jew, that made you automatically unclean. So it was something that you would remove yourself from. It made you automatically unclean. So even your best works are nothing but filthy rags. And through this, through the truth, and through the gospel, and through your belief in who Christ is, though your sins were as scarlet, they'll be as white as snow. Why? Because of that sacrifice. And when that happens, you're sealed by the Holy Spirit of God for eternity. For eternity, because that is the righteous work of God. Ephesians 5:8. For ye were sometimes darkness, but now are ye light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the Spirit is all goodness, righteousness, and truth, proving what is acceptable for the Lord, unto the Lord. So here this fruit of the Spirit, again capital S, if there's any merit found in you by your actions, they must be through the fruit of the Spirit. No one external to the Holy Spirit can produce any works that are worthy in the eyes of God. So you hear a lot of people out there, hey, I'm not so bad. Compared to who? Compared to everyone around you? Compared to an axe murderer, you know, serial rapist? You're not so bad. But when you compare yourself with the one righteous, true God, when you compare yourself to Jesus Christ on the cross, how can you look at what you have done and consider it of any merit? No, all of that has to be done through a heart that is conditioned by the Holy Spirit of God to do goodness, to do righteousness, and to do so in the truth. And the truth can only be derived from God, because that is what is proving accept what is acceptable unto the Lord. Now again, what is the Bible? The Bible is the transcendent word of God. It is written by the Holy Spirit of God, given to the men of God who penned it and gave it to us in the 66 books of the Bible that we have, the 27 in the New Testament, and the 39 in the Old Testament, were given to these men by God in order to provide us the instruction, the litmus test by which we live on earth. Because that is what we must measure everything against. God's words and thoughts are here. The rest is men muddling down here and babbling and talking. because they have no basis from which to know what is true unless they know the Word of God. 2 Thessalonians 2:13. But we are bound to give thanks always to God for you, brethren, beloved of the Lord, because God hath from the beginning chosen you to salvation through sanctification of the Spirit and belief of the truth. A lot going on there. I always tell in my Bible studies, there was one beloved king, David. There is one beloved prophet, Daniel. And there's one beloved apostle, John. But you, through Christ, are beloved by God. Now that kind of makes me shiver, doesn't it? We are beloved. We are called the beloved of the Lord. Why? Again, it's not us. It's not our merit. It's the grace of God showered down upon us. So we are called children of light. Children that are adopted in through grace. And how is that done? Because God, from the beginning, from before time began, He knew that you were coming. And He knew He would call out to you. And He knew you would respond. And from that moment of grace, when you supplicated yourself before God and humbled yourself and got on your knees and said, Lord, I am but a sinner. I need you. I need something. Something to fill the black hole of my heart that can not be filled with anything but your presence. And when you got down on your knees and you did that, God shined down upon you the grace for the sins that you had committed, will commit, and are committing right now. Forevermore, His grace covered you because you turned to Him in humble supplication. So your salvation is through sanctification of the Spirit. You don't get holy before God by what you do. You get holy before God by being sanctified and set aside by the Holy Spirit of God. And your belief in the truth. And we already discussed where you found that truth. You know, Bible study is an important part of every Christian's walk. So as prayer is with a part of every Christian's walk. Because how do you know the mind of God unless you study the mind of God? And where is the mind of God given to mankind? The Bible. Where else can you go and read Jesus' words about what He thought? Nowhere else. So if you are a Christian and you don't read the Bible, what are you reading? What are you infusing into your mind? We read in Romans 12:1 that your mind needs to be renewed. Renewed in the knowledge of God through the study of the Bible. We need that as Christians. If you don't, you're walking around as a shell not filled with anything. Yes, the Holy Spirit has you. Yes, the Holy Spirit seals you. But if you're an empty vessel, filling yourself with things of the world, not with things of God, how can you grow? Something you might want to try, and Joanna had recently, and I have recently done this last year maybe. Every morning we get together and read the Bible together. I know some mornings I don't feel like it. I know some mornings she doesn't feel like it. But when we get together and do that, the spiritual intimacy between a married couple when they do this is something I didn't realize how good it could be. Now I really look forward to that. And if we ever miss a day, I'm like, I got to get back onto that. So I'd say if you're a couple, and if you really want to have some good discussions with your spouse, because sometimes, let's face it, you don't have, every day you're living together, you don't have a wonderful thing to talk about. Yeah, we talk about the cows. That's wonderful. No doubt about it. Talk about the kids. But this gives you another layer down if you're married to a Christian. So I would encourage you to do that. Likewise with prayer. You need to have prayer in your life. If you don't have prayer in your life, how do you communicate with God? Do you communicate with God? Do you say, Lord, you know, thank you for this, thank you for that? You need to start thinking about how to do that. Because those are the two key things you can do. Yes, we're doing fellowship with the church, and that is awesome and wonderful. We need that. We need to get together as a church and sing, glorify, and pray together. Because a prayer done in groups is something that cannot be done on your own, and that's needed. But you need the individual prayer life. We really need to get into that. 2 Peter 1:12. So far we've heard from David, we've heard from Jesus, we've heard from John. Now we're going to hear from Peter about these two, with these two words in the same sentence. Seeing ye have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto unfeigned love of the brethren, see that ye love one another in a pure heart with a pure heart fervently. So not only do we have this, you know, study the Bible, pray, something called obedience. God rewards obedience. Now, once you're saved, can you do nothing with your walk and still be saved? Well, according to the Bible, when, you know, there's going to be some people that are going to get up into heaven and be there at the Bema Seat of Jesus Christ, and their works will be judged. They'll burn like, it's like iron and different kind of metals and hay and straw and wood and all this. It all gets tested. And Jesus Christ says, and some people, like, should, this is Paul talking, and some people will survive, but as escaping the flame. So none of their works will be worth anything if they did any works. So could you get into heaven and not do anything at all? Yeah, I think there's going to be examples of that. But think about it. If you're a child, if you're going to school, and you go to school, and you come home with your report card, and you say, look, Dad, I've got all D's, I passed. Wow! You know, good job! Is that what you want? No, you want a well-done, good and faithful servant. How is that done? Obedience. Obedience. Do what God said to do. He said, my sheep hear my voice. If you're his sheep, you hear his voice and do what he says. Now, what does that mean? Number one thing is faith, belief. Developing that personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Because if you don't have that, how do you do anything else? How do you do those works? How do you be a worker in the field if you don't take a hoe with you? If you don't take tools and implements that are given to you? God is going to equip you for those things and put them before you. We read in Romans 8, I think it's 24, where it says he's got good works planned for you in advance. He's got them out there for you. He's ready for you to go and get some. Now, I've heard a lot of people say, well, the Lord never really gave me that much to do. I don't get any good works. Did you look for them? Are you sitting and wait for them to come to you? No, you got to get out there and look. There's opportunities, and God will present them to you. You just got to obey. Read the Bible. Pray. Pray for that. Just be careful when you do, though. Because if you pray, he might actually give you something to do. Some works that you're not prepared for. Guess what? He will equip you if he puts you out there. I've been in situations before. I've never done any marriage counseling before, but I was on a quadrilene. Chaplain wasn't there. They said, Joe, we got somebody that needs marriage counseling. I'm like, okay. So I started riding on my bicycle. They don't have cars out there. They do, so I'm riding the bicycle. You know, I somehow envisioned myself just, you know, I'm thinking all these Bible passages, and I sat down with them, and all of a sudden it was given to me the passages in the Bible that needed to be said. That was the Holy Spirit. That wasn't me. Because I didn't know how to marry this and counsel this guy, but God knew he needed it, and he used me as a vessel. What a blessing that is. And I know that's probably happened to you too. But you have to be prepared. You have to be obedient to what God says. 1 John 4:6, we are of God, And this is John telling them that the church this. He that knoweth God heareth us. He that is not of God heareth not. Hereby we know the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. So here we have John talking to the church, encouraging them about having the spirit of truth within us. And this is our truth detector in life. This is what I was alluding to earlier. If you have the Bible, you have the knowledge of God to prepare you for this situation. And you can know the truth from error. So you have God is right, everything else is what? Error. Is not true. So that is the way we determine truth. Now I'll leave, this is the final one. This is number 12. 1 John 5, 6 through 9. This is he that came by water and blood, even Jesus Christ, not by water only, but by water and blood. So we're saying there that it's not about cleansing yourself, because the Jews did ritualistic cleansing in the kids all the time, in which they would clean themselves and present themselves before God. But they were still unrighteous, even though they were ritualistically clean, because they really needed the blood of Jesus Christ to make them clean, that one holy sacrifice. And it is the Spirit that beareth witness, because the Spirit is truth. Now notice here the Trinity as we walk through this. If anyone says the Trinity is not in the Bible, they did not read these verses. For there are three that bear record in heaven. The Father, the Word, and who's the Word? Say his name real loud. That's right. And the Word was with God. And that is Jesus Christ is the Word, the Logos. And the Holy Ghost. And these three are one. Shocker. That's the triune God. That's the Trinity. There are three gods, representation of the God. The God. And they all share a spirit. And someday I'll give you a class on the Trinity if you have any issue with that. And we'll tell you how that can be. Because it's rather confusing unless you know the nature of God. But if you know the nature of God, you know what the Trinity implies and what it is a promise for. And there are three that bear witness in earth. The Spirit, the water, and the blood. To show that we are Christians. And these three agree in one. And what we have here is the Holy Spirit. Is something that witnesses to you. You know you have the Spirit of God. You know you were cleansed ritualistically, and baptism was an outward sign of really what has occurred inside you spiritually, and the blood of Jesus Christ, which must be acknowledged for you to have that humbling faith experience with God to generate that relationship. If we receive the witness of men, the witness of God is greater. For this is a witness of God, which he hath testified of his Son. And we kind of come back full circle. In that, when David said, into thine hands, my spirit, I commit my spirit, thou hast redeemed me, O Lord, the God of truth. We come back to the acknowledgement that we must humble ourselves before God. To know what the real truth is. There's the truth of man out there, and there's the truth of God in our heart and in the Word of God. Upon that, we must live and we must depend. For without the light of the Word of God and the Holy Spirit dwelling within us, we are like the rest of the world in darkness.